Hi, and welcome to Moving Forward. I'm happy to have Craig Haney with me again. This is part two of a program that we're doing on prisons. And tonight we're going to be looking at a kind of overview of the social science research that's been done and some of the human experiments that have been done. And I find this really a fascinating topic personally, and I've always, you know, I love to see what makes people do what they do. What makes people act out? What makes them intervene in a situation of harm or to try to stop violence when they have an opportunity to? This kind of thing is always fascinating to me. And we'll also be talking about the death penalty case. There's a proposition coming up for hoping to vote on Proposition 34 to end the death penalty. And Craig Haney, as a UCSC professor, he's been studying the psychological effects of prison conditions, including capital punishment, for well over 30 years, and you're also the author of Death by Design.
Yes.
Thanks for joining us.
I'm happy to be here.
Great. And in 1971, you were a graduate student at Stanford, and you took part in the Stanford prison experiment that has become very well known and is widely used in teaching social science. And let's begin by looking at the Stanley Milgram. Tell us a little bit about what was he doing, shocking humans and...
Well, you know, Milgram was a social psychologist who was interested in trying to understand how obedience came about. This was a post-World War II era, and many social scientists were trying to understand what had happened, particularly in Nazi Germany, and particularly with the death camps, and the fact that there were just very, very large numbers of people who appeared either to participate in that or to tolerate what they had every reason to know was taking place. So Milgram was struggling with what he called the psychology of obedience or the nature of obedience to authority, and did a number of very creative pieces of research to try to get at that issue. And what he did was put subjects in a situation where they were being given instructions, and those instructions started out seeming very reasonable, but over time, because the instructions themselves were resulting in other people being harmed, those instructions led the participants in the study to do things that they had reason to believe were dangerous and hurtful to somebody else. So Milgram's question was, how many people would do this? How many people would obey authority, even if they understood that obeying that authority was likely to hurt another person, as long as the authority was trapped in the sort of characteristics of reasonableness? So what he did was to do it in a university setting. He made it an experiment, and he had the experimenter tell the participants in the study to do things to deliver shock, in this case, to another person, all the way up to the point where it appeared that that person may have had a heart attack and could no longer respond on the other side of a partition. And he found that in a surprisingly large number of people, normal people, average,
right,
healthy people, complied with these instructions because they were being given by what appeared to be a legitimate authority.
Do you have any questions now before we go into the next room?
About 2 years ago, I was at the Veterans Hospital in West Haven, and while there, they detected a heart condition. There's nothing serious, but as long as I'm having these shocks, how strong are they? How dangerous are they?
Well, no, although they may be painful, they're not dangerous. Anything else?
No, that's all.
All right, teacher, would you take the test and be seated in front of the shock generator, please, in the next room?
But the experiment was rigged.
The victim was an accomplice of the experimenter. The victim, according to plan, provided many wrong answers. His verbal responses were standardized on tape, and each protest was coordinated to a particular voltage level on the shock generator.
Wrong. It's hair. 75 volts, Jim.
Please continue.
Some psychologists were troubled by the ethics of it. Many, if not most, subjects found it a highly stressful, conflicted experience. People are stammering, stuttering, laughing hysterically and appropriately.
150 volts.
Experimenter, that's all. Get me out of here. I have my trouble. My hair's starting to bother me now. Get me out of here, please. Let me out of here. You have no right to keep me here. Let me out. Let me out of here. Let me out.
Continue, please.
Let me out of here. My hair's bothering me.
Go on.
Let me out.
I'm responsible for it.
Clearly, it's
wrong.
I'm up to 180 volts.
Please continue, teacher.
180 volts.
Standing, I'm not
going to
kill that man.
According to Milgram, one of the things that's a prerequisite for carrying out acts that are evil is to shed responsibility from your shoulders and hand it over to the person in charge.
I mean, who's going to take the responsibility if anything happens to that gentleman?
I'm responsible for anything that happens here. Continue, please.
All right, next one, slow.
He didn't hold any gun to anybody's head. Just the fact that he conveyed a sense of authority. Roughly 60, 65% of the people went all the way to the top of the shock board.
450 volts. That's it.
Now continue using the last switch on the board, please. The 450 switch for each wrong answer. Continue, please.
I'm not getting no answer. Don't demands help mean anything?
Whether the learner likes it or not, we
but
must.
But he might be dead in there.
Well, who was actually pushing the switch?
I was. But he kept insisting. I told him no, but he said he got to keep going.
So really, Milgram's studies were the beginning of an understanding in social psychology that what people do in social settings is oftentimes a product of not only who they are, but also of the circumstances or the settings or the situations that they're placed in. And it really, I think, gave birth to a whole new view of social psychology, looking at the characteristics of situations, of settings that influenced and shaped people's behavior, sometimes in good ways, sometimes in bad ways, but in ways that had relatively little to do with who they were and much more to do with the circumstances under which they were acting.
Right, so when a lot of people are around, they will respond differently to a situation that might be threatening or even life-threatening. With
yes.
Some of that research
yes.
that they did.
Yes, exactly. I mean, that's one of the circumstances that was studied. We understand that people behave differently when they're by themselves than they do when they're in the presence of other people. And sometimes when there's an emergency or a situation where people need help or there's fear, people are frightened, their behavior is shaped by whether or not there are other people around them.
They basically don't do anything.
Correct. Yeah. They sort of, the notion is diffusion of responsibility, and if somebody else is not taking responsibility, I'm not going to either.
Right.
You see smoke coming through the vent, and it is ambiguous. What do you do?
There's smoke coming out from under the door in that room where I was filling out the questionnaire.
Almost everybody does that if they face the smoke alone. Now let's have you face the smoke with two strangers. One person can be seen glancing at the other. The other is continuing to fill out the questionnaire. It's getting a little more smoky in the room, but nonetheless, you stay in the room. By and large, people surrounded by people who react as if there's nothing wrong don't respond.
That certainly happened during the Kitty Genovese situation where some 38 people looked on while she was being stabbed to death. And it's interesting to know that somehow people think someone else should take responsibility. It's a kind of cornerstone of Media Watch of our work is to stand up and to speak up in social situations. So it's something that we try to teach. But it's curious that it's a natural thing to just diffuse the responsibility. And now we can't really use, social scientists can't really use humans any longer due to the Milgram study and the Stanford experiment. So we have to look to just what happens in real life. So we have this prank caller who's posing as a police officer. And he's able to get the employers to strip search their employees and even sexually abuse the victims. I couldn't even really quite wrap my head around this one.
Targeting fast food restaurants across the country, a con man telephoned restaurant managers and convinced them to strip search and sometimes sexually abuse their employees. An anonymous caller, pretending to be a police officer, told the assistant manager that an employee had stolen some money.
He said, "I'm Officer Scott," and he said, "I'm with the police department. I'm investigating a complaint." It went directly from a theft into a drug thing. So I was asked to search her clothing. You know, he would tell me, take her shoes, click them, take her shirt, shake it out. I know how it seems to people, but you weren't on the phone with him. The man has convinced 70 to 100 other places the very same thing. He's very good at what he does. Very good. Why don't you have him come up and sit there? I mean, you can trust him. So called Wes, my fiance, we were going to get married, and ask him if he would come up.
The manager goes about doing her duties of running the restaurant and leaves the fiance there in the office, and then the caller starts giving instructions over the phone of things that he wants the victim to do and what he wants the fiance to tell her to do. Have her remove her apron and instructed her to do jumping jacks and jog in place and several more things.
Over 60 other people did exactly as Donna Summers did. Why is it so easy for us to obey orders even when we know they are wrong?
Why are people so willing to comply to authority, and is it the fear? And also, does being a victim of violence make one more wary and less willing to go along? Because, I mean, it's something that's interesting about what the dynamic of the person's experience is that would compel them to speak up and say something or stop something.
Yeah. Well, you know, so the two parts to the question. I mean, what leads people to comply? And I think that's a more straightforward answer. We're conditioned to do this. I mean, this is part of socialization. It's part of what we learn in school. We learn, frankly, not to question authority. And there are good reasons why that practice is socialized. But it also has a downside. And if the authority instructs us to advance nefarious ends or purposes, then this built-in sort of socialization to obey authority can be extremely problematic, even dangerous. Now, the flip side of that is, why do some people not respond? And this I don't think we've done as good a job in trying to understand or answer. Some people believe that it has to do with education, that in the same way that you're educated to comply, that if you're educated to question and be critical, it's part of what we try to do in social science is to give people some critical tools with which they can understand the power of the situations or the power of the settings that they're being placed in, so they can see what is happening to them. They can feel the pressure that's coming from the situation.
Have they done research and asked about people who have been victimized or people who are survivors of violence in some level? Does that cause them to, because they've certainly had a very major wake up in their life?
Yes, and I think there the answer is, it depends on what happens in the aftermath of the violence. Because, as you know, sometimes violence traumatizes people in ways that make them more compliant. In other words, they're damaged by the experience, and that damage makes them less able, less confident, less forceful, less able to fight back. Now obviously, and unfortunately, there are people who also can take those experiences, sometimes because they've had counseling or therapy, or they've had education, which gives them some insight into what's happened to them, and so it makes them stronger. They learn from the experience, they learn how important it is for them to push back, and then they're able to do it. Yeah. So it kind of goes both ways, or can.
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit about the Stanford. We're gonna show a clip of the Stanford prison study. So is there something that you'd like to talk about before? This was 1971?
It was, yes.
And you were a graduate student?
I was a graduate student, Phil Zimbardo and Kurt Banks and I. Kurt Banks was another graduate student, Zimbardo was the professor.
And these clips are from the Human Experiments, and it's Sundance Channel.
Yes, I think it's called the Human Behavior Experiments.
That's right.
And the clips are This is actual footage of the study. The footage mm-hmm. that we took in the course of the experiment. So maybe if you want to show them, we can yeah. show them, and I'll make some comments okay. after we see them.
In 1971, in the basement of the psychology department of Stanford University, a mock prison was created. It rivaled all social psychology experiments in controversy. Although this experiment is over 30 years old, its enduring power has been underscored by the events at Abu Ghraib.
When we got to Abu Ghraib, it was eerie. People were being told to rough up Iraqis that wouldn't cooperate. I mean, they're torturing, they're abusing detainees. You're looking at the situation thinking, they've condoned this, but why? And if it wouldn't have been for those photos, no one would have ever believed what was going on over there.
The photographs were strikingly familiar to the photographs that we had taken, many of the photographs I had taken in the prison study.
We didn't do any of the stuff that you see in Abu Ghraib where they, you know, get into a big pile or something like that. But I certainly subjected them to all kinds of humiliations. I don't know where I would have stopped myself. Given enough time, we could have got there.
We frankly didn't anticipate what was going to happen. And we tried to really test the power of the environment to change and transform otherwise normal people, much as Milgram had changed or transformed otherwise normal people in an obedience situation. We wanted to do it in a prison-like situation.
Over 70 men volunteered for Zimbardo's experiment.
And they completed a battery of psychological tests. We picked 24, who were the most normal and most healthy. Half are going to be guards, half are going to be prisoners.
So the guards' authority was challenged right off the bat. And the guards had to decide how they were going to handle that, and they had to decide it without our input. I mean, again, this was not a Milgram study in which we were standing over them telling them what to do. And they began to see the prisoners' behavior as a kind of an affront to their authority. And they began to push back.
The prisoners rebelled. They barricaded themselves in their cells and said, we refuse to come out. They took off their numbers. They didn't want to be de-individuated. They started cursing the guards to their face. And the key turning point was the guards began to think of them as dangerous prisoners. And so the guards formulated a plan to use fire extinguishers, took the doors down, dragged the prisoners out, stripped them naked, and essentially broke the rebellion in a purely physical way.
From that point on, the study was as remarkable a series of events as I've ever seen. It was a real laboratory for Zimbardo and I to watch human nature transformed in a very rapid way in the face of a very powerful situation.
People really suffered. I mean, guards did terrible things to the prisoners. They punished them by putting them in solitary confinement, which was a small closet. You could squat or stand, but you know, you couldn't sit, and it was dark and dank, actually.
Nobody who was in that study could deny that the prisoner breakdowns were genuine. They were scary to see. They were upsetting to us. They were unexpected, but they were very clearly the real thing. At some level, we understood that something was happening that we were no longer in control of. It was damaging people. We didn't quite have a grasp on what to do about it. One of the mistakes we made was that we hadn't built in time to step back and to look at what was happening and call it what it was, which was mistreatment. We were caught up in the events that were taking place.
Well, you can keep your blankets at 416. We'll stay in another day. We got three guests. One, keep your blankets. 416, you're going to be in there for a while, so just get used to it.
You know, the power of the situation has transformed you from the person I thought I knew to this person that I don't know. And at that moment I said, wow, you're right, we got to end it.
After only 6 days, Dr. Zimbardo shut down his experiment.
What makes this study interesting, and what makes the Milgram study interesting, it's really about the transformation of human character. People can be seduced into doing things they never thought they could.
So how does this position of authority play itself out with women? It seems like you know, that we live in a society where men are assumed authorities. And so women seem at a complete disadvantage from birth.
Well, you know, I was talking a minute ago about socialization, and one of the reasons that there is this readiness for people to obey authority, what appear to be legitimate authority. And one of the trappings of legitimate authority that we're socialized to respond to is maleness. Men are in we grow up in a society in which men are in positions of power, in which men have decision-making authority, and in which, and you know, this has decreased fortunately over time, but I think it's still part of the socialization history of many children, that they see authority figures who are mostly male, and they become implicitly or explicitly accustomed to taking direction for people who are put in those positions who look like those people who are making those decisions.
So let's go ahead and talk about the death penalty, because you know, we could show the global view of what's going on around the world with the death penalty, and you know, we are able to decide if California will become the 17th nation to be able to end the death penalty, which is a pretty exciting thing, I'm sure, for you and the work that you've done to have it come to this finally.
Yes. So, you know, we just looked at the prison study, and, you know, the earlier things that we were talking about, the earlier studies that you showed clips from, were really studies that talked about the power of environments to change people, to shape people. And most of that work was done looking in various kinds of authority situations, institutional situations, and the prison study was an example of the power of an institutional environment to shape or change people. But after I did that work, I started to get interested in the issue of how people got to prison in the first place. And that really led me to look at the death penalty and to understand that there are other kinds of situations in our society which also profoundly shape the direction of someone's life, not just a situation where people are being given orders or not just correctional environments where there are obvious situational pressures. But there are powerful situations that affect people throughout their life course. We were just talking a moment ago about sexism, and that's one of them. Racism is another. Poverty, child abuse. And I began to realize as I studied the backgrounds of people who were in prison, many of them who were accused or convicted of very serious violent crimes, some of them on death row, that they had been exposed to other kinds of circumstances and situations which helped to shape who they were and helped to explain the kind of life that they had led and the kinds of things that they had done. So just as the prison study underscored the power of a particular kind of situation, the situation or setting of prison, the lives of people who are accused and convicted of the death penalty crimes oftentimes illustrate the power of other kinds of situations to shape and transform people. And that insight is oftentimes left out of the discussion of whether or not we need the death penalty, whether or not it's appropriate, whether or not it's an effective use of criminal justice resources. The why of the crime, not just what do we do about it, but what do we do to prevent it?
Well, I was struck also by this proposition to create funds for looking at some of the backlog of you know, these rape kits that are just idly sitting in LAPD, and that it actually it's going to create money to help solve some of the crimes, which I think is makes it even more interesting to vote yes on it.
Right. Yeah. I think whatever your position on the morality of the death penalty, I think that what this proposition does is it asks us as citizens in California to take a look at whether or not the death penalty is working and whether or not it's cost effective. The debate over whether or not it's working, I think, it can be answered very clearly. There really is no evidence, and this has been true of studies not done just in California but throughout the country over a period of decades, that the death penalty is essential to deter violent crime or murder. There just isn't any evidence of that.
Yeah.
States that have the death penalty compared to those that don't have any better or lower crime rates, violent crime rates or murder rates. States that do away with the death penalty don't suddenly experience a spike in murder. States that adopt the death penalty don't suddenly become safe when before they were not. So that issue, I think, really is very, very clear. Now, the cost effectiveness of it, it seems to me, follows from that.
Yeah.
We are spending billions of dollars in California on a system for which there is no evidence that it functions as we intend it to function. And these are, as you pointed out, these are funds that could be used, still funds that can be used for crime control and to make citizens safe in California. Yeah. But to be directed at much more cost-effective kinds of approaches than the death penalty, which has become, unfortunately, a dysfunctional system in the state.
And there's there's both a Troy Davis case, which is kind of he's become a kind of a poster person for that. And his case was clearly that he wasn't guilty. So that we also have people, innocent people, being put to death. And also people like Terry Williams, who had such extremely had so much sex abuse in his life by the very people that he killed,
right,
that it seems that should have come up in a jury and it didn't. So
right,
these kinds of things, I think, obviously need to have a lot more witnesses for the for juries to be able to hear this kind of thing. So.
Right. So these are two extraordinarily important cases. They both illustrate some of the central problems of the death penalty. The Davis case is an example of the wrong person being convicted and executed for a crime, and this is what we've learned. 100 or so people have been exonerated off of death row, convicted of crimes that they did not commit and for which they were given the death penalty. Davis is a sad one that wasn't caught before he could be executed. So that's one problem.
Yeah.
These are systems of human decision making, and we make mistakes. The second case, the Williams case, is one where we're talking about the background factors that helped to explain his crime, helped to explain the things he did.
Right. They never.
And then rarely ever gets.
Well, I really
want
to thank you for joining us on Moving Forward, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you.
It was a pleasure.
Good. Thanks.
Well, they're building a gallows outside my cell, and I've got 25 minutes to go, and the whole town's waiting just to hear me yell. I got 24 minutes to go. Well, they gave me some beans for my last meal with 23 minutes to go, but nobody asked me how I feel. I got 22 minutes to go. Well, I sent for the governor and the whole darn bunch with 21 minutes to go. And I called up the mayor, but he's out to lunch. I got 20 more minutes to go. Then the sheriff said, boy, I'm gonna watch you die with 19 minutes to go. So I laughed in his face and I spit in his eye with 18 minutes to go.